Matthew 7, verse 7. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And to the one who knocks, the door will be opened. Which of you, if your son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? So in everything, do to others what you would have them do, for this sums up the law and the prophets. Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. But small is the gate, and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. Watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious. By their fruit you will recognize them. Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus, by your fruit, you will recognize them. You will what? You will recognize them. Better be bearing some fruit. No one can say that. I mean, is Jesus preaching a works-based ministry? No, he's saying you must bear fruit. You must bear fruit. Just like James said, faith without works is dead. By your fruit, you will be recognized. By their fruit, you will recognize them. By their fruit, Jesus recognized who were his. And in the book of John, he very clearly said to people, to the Jews who were telling him, we're Abraham's children and, you know, touting that story. What did Jesus tell him? If you were Abraham's children, you would do what Abraham does. He directly said to them, you are children of the devil. And he asked the question rhetorically, why is it that you can't understand my language? Why is my message unclear to you? Because you are children of the devil. So he asks the question, then he answers the question. His sheep know his voice and they follow him. Not just his sheep know his voice, because you can hear from God. Stop giving yourself credit for that. But unless you follow him, that's not going to be to your credit. That's what he's doing. His sheep hear his voice and follow his voice. His sheep know his voice and obey his voice. And by their fruit, you will recognize them. That is also the reason why you've been told by John to test the spirit. Don't believe every spirit. I mean, my goodness, if we believed everyone who called themselves Christian, show me you're a Christian. Tell me you're a Christian without telling me you're a Christian. To speak in today's terms, bear the fruit. Bear fruit in keeping with repentance. Bear fruit in keeping with love and the image of God. Bear fruit in keeping with truth. If you're bearing the fruit of being a coward, then I discern that you are not from him. You got to speak the truth. You need to produce fruit, produce works. Though it's not a works based in, it is a faith based outward. If it's in your heart, it's going to come out of your right hand, your deeds, your forehead, your thoughts, your mouth, the things you declare. That is either the mark of the beast is coming from your heart and out of that right hand and forehead, or the seal of God is coming out of your right hand and your forehead. You got to make the decision. What's it going to be? Because if you have a heart for God, but you, or you think you have a heart for God, but you keep saying things like what I hear on this channel quite frequently, I don't know if I'm one of the ones. I don't know if I'm one of the ones. Why are you saying that? Go make sure. Go return to him. Make sure you're one of the ones. Be moved by him. What did he say? He said, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. But you got to really seek him. You got to really return to him. What has he said since the beginning of the Bible in the Old Testament? Return to me and I will return to you and I will heal you. And healing and salvation are synonymous. We also need to be heeding what it is that he's saying. But small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life. It's not something that's easy, guys. If the gate is small and narrow is the road that leads to life, then have you ever been through a small gate? You kind of got to shimmy your way into that small space, don't you? It requires a little work. It's not like what counterfeit Christianity is preaching, which is everybody welcome. Rainbow, rainbow, rainbow. Love, love, love. This is an inclusive church. I don't know what they're talking about, because the Bible that I'm reading to you right now says, enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. So what those churches are doing is just welcoming everybody to hell. Did you ever see Pinocchio when you were a kid? As much as I hate Disney, I think Pinocchio is a pretty good example. That story is a pretty good example of how easy it is to fall into falsehood and be destroyed. Wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. But small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. Watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. By their fruit, you will recognize them. Are you guys recognizing? Because a lot of you are listening to a lot of people on YouTube, and that is so, so dangerous. You will be just as guilty. This is what the word tells us. You will be as guilty as the false prophets and false teachers you are listening to. As guilty. Why? Because you didn't love truth. Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Think about it. I mean, are you going to get anything good from there? Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus, by their fruit, you will recognize them. Also, by their fruit, you will be recognized. The next thing he says should terrify you. It should make you tremble. It should make you return. Not sit here and like helplessly act like you don't have the ability to return right now. You have a narrow window right now to return. So do it. I tell you how to do it. You need to fast and you need to pray and you need to rend your heart to him. Your heart, not your flesh, not your desperate flesh. Oh, Lord, Lord, make sure that I'm one of the ones. No, bring your heart to him. Start searching yourself. Start searching his word. Now listen, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who, what's he going to say? What's he going to say right now? Because it's important and you should know what he's going to say right now. Who's going to enter the kingdom of heaven? Only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. That's what it means to be in the name and to pray in the name, not in the name of Jesus. And then everyone fights about the real name of Jesus and the real name of the Father. That's without understanding. Those different names have been provided because each one represents an aspect of God. You're going to put him in a box? The name, when he made a name for himself, he made a reputation, a will, a cause, a reason, a purpose. Are you in the name? Are you praying in that cause, reason, and purpose? Or are you praying for your own motives? Are you praying for your own life, for your own will, for your own desires? Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and draw in your name, drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. These are people who think they're in him. And he says, they're many. They're many. And he says those getting into the kingdom are few, and he's not exaggerating. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and, what's he going to say, puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. When Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching because he taught as one who had authority and not as their teachers of the law. I mean, I think about that and I just think, I mean, they're cowards. They're absolute cowards because they don't return to God. They don't teach according to, they don't sit in his council. They're too cowardly to actually go and sit in the council of God because they would have to examine themselves. they would have to admit that God has not appointed them to the position that they are faking. They're frauds, hypocrites. And Jesus told us from the very beginning, beware of the yeast of the Pharisees, didn't he? Frauds, hypocrites, guilty. They're guilty because they claim to see. That's what Jesus told them in the book of John. Now, God led me to this particular passage of scripture this morning because he's actually been pointing out to me all of these train derailments, which, like, I don't ever remember hearing about train derailments the way this, that we've been, or the, with the frequency that we've been hearing about them. It used to be like, you know, an odd thing that would happen, but it's happening all over the world. And so he's been kind of drawing my attention to it for a while. And I finally sat down with him this morning and was like, what's up with this? What's going on here? Why are you drawing my attention to this morning? And to be honest, I kind of felt when I first asked the question, and I was kind of going around, about my morning, I was kind of feeling like, it doesn't talk about train derailments in the Bible. How's he going to talk to me about this? But he spoke to me about it very easily and very clearly and quickly. So I share that with you because I think that a lot of times, we try to control like what the message is that God is speaking to us, or we try to fabricate it. None of that is necessary. The only thing that's necessary is that we sit and write out in a way that he's taught us. Like he's taught us to pay attention to what it is that we're feeling and to follow his spirit. And those things go hand in hand. They're not mutually exclusive. In order to know what you're feeling and what you're feeling from him, what you're hearing and what you're hearing from yourself, you have to have some distinction between what your own thoughts are and what your own feelings are versus the feelings that you're getting from the Holy Spirit and the promptings and communication that he's bringing. If you are not in contact with yourself, you're not attuned to yourself, guess what? You are not going to be able to be attuned to God. If you're living in your flesh, you're going to hear from the devil who disguises him as an angel of light. But if you're living in the heart where he's communicating, where he's cleaning you up, and in the spirit, by his spirit, remember that the spirit he gave you is willing. It's your flesh that's weak. So that is the place where you need to live. So first thing that I did was I sat down, started writing out my own feelings so I can get in contact with what it is that I'm feeling. And I can also, and I can process that, and I can distinguish between what I'm feeling and thinking versus what the Holy Spirit is communicating to me. And then I heard him ask or prompt me to write out what I'm feeling with regard to a train derailment. Because if I were doing this of my own understanding, I might go, okay, what are some synonyms for derailment? And then go look in the Bible. But see, I don't need to control that. I need to follow him. So I started to describe it. You know, a train really needs to stay on that path. It needs the tracks. It's not capable of taking another path just because the conductor decided, well, I want to go over here instead of remain on these tracks. The train needs those tracks. When the train becomes derailed, there is destruction. What's the message of this scripture? Stay on that track. Stay on that path. Doesn't matter how narrow it is. Doesn't matter how small it is. Doesn't matter what everybody else is doing. Stay on that path. You need those tracks. If you want to get to where you're going, you want to get to your destination, you got to stay on the tracks. If you become derailed, you're going to be falling off. And that's really what's happening right now with these trumpets. Those people are getting left in the dust. They've made their decisions, even many of them being exposed to, you know, what the witnesses are saying right now, the truth, but they're making their own decision to just go off on their own. Objects of destruction, objects of wrath. So the message to you is stay on the tracks. I know there's all of this countryside you want to go explore. Stay on the tracks. All of those people who think they're living their best life here, who are living for the world and doing everything that appeals to their flesh, they're not going to get to that destination. They're being derailed. They're following what their itching ears want to hear. And you heard what their destination is. Their destiny is that they're going to be certain of their so-called blessed assurance. And they are the ones who are going to be saying, Lord, Lord, but didn't we do this in your name and that in your name? And why aren't we going with you? What is he going to say? I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. I really hope you'll discern this with God and heed the warning. Thank you for listening.